In the past two classes, I discussed the dominant practice of legal analysis in the context of the history of legal thought, that is, the internal context. I compared it to its precursor. In today's class, my program is to place the dominant practice of legal analysis in another context, its external context, its relation to the dominant institutional and ideological settlement in society. And then in the remaining classes before the break, I want to develop an argument about the internal architecture of this form of legal analysis, with the intention of revealing its central problems and costs, and thus signaling a direction to the future. The purposive generalizing and idealizing style of legal analysis, principle-based or policy-oriented, which I called in an earlier class the method of reasoned elaboration, and now enjoys canonical authority in the major world centers of legal culture, has an intimate relation to the last major moment of institutional and ideological refoundation in the North Atlantic region of the world. In the mid-20th century, these societies rearrange themselves in the context of economic crisis and war. In a form that in Europe we describe as social democracy, and in the United States as the New Deal settlement. We can understand this refoundation, this reshaping, as a kind of bargain. On the one hand, the forces that challenge the established organization of production and of power, that is to say, of the economy and of the state, renounced this challenge. And on the other hand, in exchange, as it were, for this renunciation, the state was allowed to acquire the power to manage the economy countercyclically through the instruments of monetary and fiscal policy, to regulate the economy more intensively, and above all, to attenuate the inequalities generated in the market by resorting to retrospective and compensatory redistribution through tax and transfer, that is to say, through progressive taxation and through redistributive social spending. So the attenuation of inequality, rather than occurring through institutional innovations intended to influence the primary distribution of economic advantage, occurred through devices intended to correct after the fact the distribution of economic advantage. After the fact, that is to say, through corrective redistribution by tax and transfer. And it is this settlement, with its institutional and its ideological aspects, that we can call the social democratic compromise, and that in the United States went under the name of the New Deal. In its inception, this style of legal analysis that is now predominant and exercises a seductive influence throughout the world, had an intimate relation to this political and economic and ideological event of the mid-20th century. It is inseparable from that institutional and ideological reshaping. It is a generalization of it in the categories of law and an idealization of it in the language of impersonal policy and principle. That's how I am seeing the basic broader historical context of this new practice of legal analysis. In narrower and technical legal terms, the form of this settlement was the superimposition of a new body of public law on a largely unrevised body of private law. The private law of property and contract, of tort and restitution, expressed a certain way of organizing the market economy. In the mid-20th century, this inherited body of private law was very little revised. And what happened in legal terms was that a new body of public law organizing the regulatory and redistributive activity of the state under the terms of the Social Democratic Compromise was superimposed on this largely unchanged body of private law. So you can see that this legal compromise was the straightforward expression in law, in legal thought, of what I just described as the Social Democratic Compromise. Now, I want to say a word again about the broader intellectual and ideological form of this compromise. It would not have achieved, and it would not have maintained its plausibility, its authority, even its appearance of near self-evidence, if it had not been reinforced and did not continue to be reinforced by the major currents of thought throughout the social sciences and humanities. And so I now return to a remark that I made before about three major tendencies across the whole field of social studies. In the hard positive social sciences, economics first among them, rationalizing tendencies prevail. That is to say, the representation of the established institutions as the natural or necessary or best outcome of a quasi-Darwinian evolution converging toward best practice throughout the world, defining what works best and winnowing out what works less well. A functionalist representation of the established institutional arrangements as the arrangements demonstrated to be most effective. That in the hard positive social sciences. In the normative disciplines of political philosophy and legal theory, philosophical or pseudo-philosophical constructions intended to justify the humanization or the improvement of this arrangement, of this established institutional and ideological settlement by two main devices. The first device is compensatory redistribution, retrospective redistribution through tax and transfer. And the second device is the idealization of law. In the language of impersonal policy and principle, as the expression of an intelligible and defensible plan of social life, not just an ad hoc, random collision or compromise among clashing interests and visions. In political philosophy, then, a philosophical gloss provided by the most influential theories of justice on the homely practices of redistribution under social democracy. The theories of justice appear to be very abstract, but they have a very tangible target. The tangible target is the justification of the bottom line. The bottom line is compensatory redistribution through progressive taxation and social spending, rather than any ambitious program for the institutional reshaping of the arrangements of the state or the economy. And in law, the objective is to represent this social democratic compromise of the mid-20th century as not simply an ad hoc truce in a temporarily interrupted war among interests and visions, but as a plan that could be conceived and justified by the mind and expressed in abstract ideas and thus ultimately systematized in the categories of legal thought. The third tendency, alongside the rationalizing tendency of the hard positive social sciences, and the humanizing tendency of the normative disciplines, was the escapist tendency in the humanities, a subjectivist adventurism, detached from any effort to reimagine and remake the structure of society. And this third tendency is then accompanied by a characteristic spiritual attitude, which is to mark a radical contrast between the public and the private worlds. The public world is, according to this view, the realm of hard and modest and realistic efficiencies and equities. And the private world is the terrain for the pursuit of higher aspirations, privatized sublimities excluded from the public world. So the idea is that the attempt to extend the pursuit of radical transformation or of humanity or of society in politics, in political action, leads to calamities, as were the calamities of 20th century politics. And we must therefore distinguish between the hot private realm, where the sublime continues to be pursued, and the cold public realm, which is the sphere of negotiation, of marginal improvement, of the balancing of equity and efficiency. So the whole program of legal thought that we are now exploring and that has now become predominant in the world, should I want to claim, be seen in this setting. The setting of this political economic compromise hammered out in the period immediately before and after the Second World War, And in the setting of these intellectual tendencies that I have just described, the rationalizing, humanizing, and escapist tendencies, their proponents, the proponents of these tendencies, represent themselves as antagonists of one another, but they are in fact allies, they are partners. In their fundamental attitude of acceptance of the terms of this compromise. That's how I am proposing to see the larger external context of this now dominant practice of legal analysis. Now, before I go on to the next step in my argument, let me stop and ask whether someone would like to question or comment on this first set of ideas. Yes?
I'm starting to see this marked change in the humanities in the 20th century. So I'm wondering if you could point to any examples or any changes in that publishing sense, literary sense that supports this.
Well, it's very familiar, actually, and it goes under a familiar label in the study of the humanities, which is the division between leftism and modernism. So the great modernist authors, Proust, Joyce, Musil, Kafka, Virginia Woolf, explored personal life and the interaction among people. But in a context that offered no promise of the transformation of society. And they radically deepened our insight into people and into the relations among people. But they despaired of politics. On the other hand, the leftist tradition continued to rely on what may seem to us in the light of this modernist instruction of the 20th century, very primitive ideas about human nature, which they had inherited from earlier philosophy and social theory. And this has had, to my mind, destructive consequences for both modernism and leftism, this radical separation of the personal and the political. So that our political ideas are informed by very crude views of humanity. And our ideas about personality and personal interaction are sundered from any imagination of society and its transformation. So that is not just a characteristic, but I believe a widely recognized feature of the evolution of our beliefs in the present age. So I'm adding that as a feature of the background to this dominant practice of legal analysis, because I doubt that it would enjoy the semblance of authority or self-evidence that it has if this background were different. That's the background. Yes? I think so. I think, let's take your example of behavioral economics. I don't see behavioral economics as having any institutional message at all. So the major apparent deviation in the economics of the 20th century was Keynes's economics, with its emphasis on permanent disequilibrium or multiple equilibria. But in one respect, Keynes's economics is entirely orthodox in the tradition of English political economy, which is that it privileges psychological phenomena and is almost entirely bereft of any structural or institutional message. So the crucial categories in Keynes's economics are categories like the propensity to consume, the preference for liquidity, and the state of long-term expectations. And these categories are entirely psychological. Following the long psychologizing tradition of English political economy and its absence of any institutional interest. So even the so-called institutional economics, which exists, which would be a more obvious example to make your point, is, I think, not really an institutional economics at all, because it wants to understand the framework of the institutions of the market by extension for the same, to the same, of the same arguments or the same moves by which we explain maximizing decisions within the established framework. Why these institutions and not other institutions? That is, the overall message of the so-called institutional economics is that the existing institutions of the market economy are somehow more or less natural, that they resulted from what I just described as this quasi-Darwinian evolution, and that the market can have no alternative form. By the way, in direct contradiction, as I suggested to an earlier class, to the main analytical achievement of legal thought in the preceding 150 years, which was to demonstrate the legal and institutional indeterminacy of the market, that the market has no natural and necessary form. So this is all part of the background. And I think a great complication and a source of the charm of the kind of argument that I would like to develop is that it is entirely against the spirit of the now dominant tendencies across the social studies and humanities. In the very first class, I recalled a phrase of Voltaire's, which seems appropriate to restate in this context, which is that those who lack the spirit of their age will nevertheless have all of its defects. So I think it's a warning that we should remember, but not to discourage us, but only to steel us for a struggle that may be larger than we expect. Someone else had his hand up? All right, so now, having stated this first set of ideas, now I want to go on to the second step in the argument. Also developing comments that I made earlier. So what is our relation today and the relation of the dominant practice of legal analysis today to this institutional and ideological settlement of the mid-20th century? So first let me state a general idea about these refoundations, these changes of the settlement, and use the context of American history as my example. So you could say that in the United States, in the history of the United States, there have been three main moments of institutional and ideological refoundation. The first moment was the initial moment, the foundation of the Republic, the constitutional moment. The second moment was the Civil War and Reconstruction. And the third moment was the New Deal in the context of Depression and World War. These were the three main moments of ideological and institutional refoundation. And each of them provided a source of guidance for legal thought. There's a very simple and basic way of understanding the course of legal history, is to say that the occupation of the jurists has been to organize in law and in legal thought the settlement and the message of each of these moments of refoundation. Now, there seems to be a characteristic rhythm which we can explore in the context of the most recent refoundation. The most recent refoundation was this social democratic compromise, this New Deal compromise of the mid-20th century. Now, a long time has already gone by, 70 years, 80 years. But no equivalent refoundation has occurred since then. So there are three characteristic moments. And the jurists perform a different role in each of these moments. So the first moment is the moment of refoundation itself, which there's a struggle and a reshaping of the institutional arrangements and of the ideological commitments or assumptions associated with them. And in this moment, typically, the jurists, if they are not enemies of the refoundation, are architects of it. So they are a segment of the elites, of the state elite, helping to design the refoundation. A part of the American legal elite participated in the design of the New Deal settlement actively. The whole structure of regulation and redistribution of the new public law and of the administrative agencies. And some of the jurists, of course, attempted to suppress. So there was a polarization within the jurists in this moment of refoundation. And this moment of refoundation went from the beginning of the New Deal in the United States to the end of the Second World War. The organization of the war economy in the United States is a separate and fascinating chapter in legal history. Then comes a second moment. The second moment is the moment of normalization. So metaphorically, think of it, so there's heat in this first moment, the moment of the struggle and of the initial architecture. And then comes the moment of the light, where this new way of organizing things has to be systematized as law. As law and as legal thought. And it has to be worked out in detail. So the detailed expression of the initial architecture is not immediately obvious. And that the work of the jurists is then to elaborate in institutional and legal detail the settlement struck at the moment of refoundation. Now, by the way, I recall that the way in which I'm conceiving this settlement is not by the terms of classical European social theory, which follows what I have called the systemic illusion, that is, that there's a small menu of alternative social, economic, and political regimes, that each of them is an indivisible system, and that if you're not in one system, you're in another. So there's feudalism, or capitalism, or socialism. It's not like that at all. There is no such simple systemic substitution. There's an ad hoc compromise. And retrospectively, the ad hoc compromise is then systematized and idealized in different realms of professional practice and thought. And the one with the most intimate relation to the organization of the institutional arrangements is law. So in the United States, we can trace that period of normalization of the New Deal compromise from the end of the Second World War to the mid-70s, so a 30-year period. And there was an equivalent transformation in Europe. And then the major schools of legal thought begin to emerge in this context, and they propose different ways of understanding in law this project of the settlement. So I'll give you an example of one of these schools. I'll mention them later in another context. The legal process school. So it said, under the traditional form of legal thought, we think only of judges. But we should think of the legal process as an organization of a set of distinct institutional roles. The judge, the legislature, the administrative agency, and the private orderer. And each of them has a distinct responsibility in the development of this plan of the settlement, of the regulated social market economy. There are different methods of decision and analysis appropriate to each of the institutional roles. So the view was, it's a kind of teamwork among those who perform these institutional roles. And the teamwork is oriented to the execution of the same plan. And what's the plan? The plan is the plan determined by the earlier compromise. Then comes a third moment. After the heat and the light, what I call the darkening. So that's the moment in which we continue to be. And it goes from the mid-1970s in the United States to today. And no one knows when it will end, because there's no sign on the horizon of another refoundation. No great economic or military crisis of the dimension of the crises that produced the earlier moments of refoundation. So it could go on for a very long time, if not indefinitely. And what then are the characteristics of legal culture in this third moment, the moment that I'm calling darkening? So the settlement recedes. It recedes into the past. And as it recedes into the past, it loses both clarity and authority. It ceases to speak to the living fights of today. So, for example, the struggles over affirmative action, or over abortion, or over the trade deals of the American government, like NAFTA, or the Trans-Pacific Partnership. How does the New Deal settlement resolve those issues? It seems that it doesn't resolve them at all. It doesn't speak to them directly. so then the source of orientation in legal thought begins to fade. That's the most fundamental characteristic of what I'm calling the period of darkening. And to this fundamental characteristic, we can then add a series of attributes. So one attribute is disorientation. There's no clear guidance. So we have to look for guidance. For example, in some theoretical conception. A second characteristic is what you could call half-belief. Now, let me explain what I mean by analogy to a common attitude in religion, which is the sentimental will to believe. So many people desire to believe, but they can't completely believe. So they half believe. They believe and they don't believe. Now, this is very interesting, a very interesting characteristic of our situation. And it's one on which I'd like you to reflect, taking your own experience, if you are law students, as the basis. Do people believe, or to what extent do they believe, in the assumptions of this now dominant practice of legal analysis, that latent in the law is a narrative of policy and principle, that it's a kind of evolving system. And this is the method that continues to prevail largely in the classroom and in the law review articles. But my impression is that the teachers and the authors don't really completely believe in the assumptions of this practice. So they may believe in it to some extent, as by analogy to the sentimental will to believe in religion, but not fully. And thus this category that I suggest to you of half-belief. Yes?
I think what the attitude is, at least for me, is that even if you don't believe that you're painting a real pipe, it at least looks like a pipe and you're very good at it. And if you come here, then you feel like you have some mastery over this and you can use it to...
You can use it, yes, go on. You can use it...
To further advance your own agenda
Or even better, or yes, to obtain power. Or we can be more noble and say, to advance beneficial social ends. So that leads to the third attribute, which is the strategic attitude. So if I'm advancing a goal as just a citizen or an ideologist, I'm just like everyone else. But if I am representing my views in the name of the authority of the law and of the elaboration of legal thought, then I have an advantage over my opponents. So it's like a noble lie in Plato. I don't completely believe in it, but I can use it to benevolent ends. Yes?
Yeah, actually, there was a case that we read today in criminal law where this judge didn't really believe that what he was saying was true. He was couching a case against convicting a rape suspect in terms of like the woman's sense of honor.
Yes.
But what, like critically, what he was really thinking of, looking at the context, was like race-based accusations of rape. But he was couching it in terms of like traditional notions of women's fragility.
Yes.
So I think there's like a lot of levels of code-switching.
Correct. So a familiar experience for academics is that they have a certain intention to develop a message, but they feel constrained to filter the intention through an analytic apparatus, a form of argument that is acceptable in their discipline. And we know that. But here, there's this additional complication, which I just described as half-belief, and in which the agent has a strategic attitude to the form of discourse that he's using. So if you took one of the authors of these law review articles, these conventional law review articles, and engaged them directly in conversation, you'd often find that they have a much wider form of beliefs. But in the text, the argument appears in this stilted, stereotyped form, which is what's acceptable. Now, the reverse side of this strategic attitude is what you could call an ironic relation to one's own discourse. So you don't believe in it completely. And this provides a great obstacle to transformation, as I suggested to you in our very first class. So I have often had the experience in discussing what I view as a dominant intellectual practice, of finding that the people in front of me say, well, I never really believed in that anyway. So it's, I use it as a tool, but I have no intimate identification with it. So this is what I'm calling the ironic attitude, in which you're learning the style of legal analysis as you might learn to play the piano, but you don't see it as a set of beliefs with which you intimately identify. Yes? What do you mean, what do you mean, face it myself?
As in, did you feel that you had this ironic attitude towards the system of government in Brazil, whereas you didn't really believe in how it was?
No, I didn't feel that. No, because I didn't proceed in that way. But as a result, I made lots of people angry. I said what I thought. But this is another conversation. About politics. So it's not that one doesn't have reasons to be circumspect. And there is what Max Weber called an ethic of responsibility and not just an ethic of conviction. But I think this problem that we're dealing with is somewhat different. It's a problem of not being able to identify with the practice that you use. I think that there's a great cost to this, a cognitive cost and a moral cost, which is that it's very hard to evolve without identification. So you contrast two situations. So one situation is you have a faith, you lose your faith, you're disillusioned. Then you struggle to acquire another faith. So then there's an evolution. But if your situation is your apparent beliefs, your expressed beliefs, are not beliefs that you actually hold, or they are beliefs that you only half hold, it's as if you were casting a spell on yourself. You're fossilizing yourself. So You cannot undergo the dialectic of disillusionment and disillusionment with disillusionment and struggle for another faith. There's no dynamic of self-transformation, of transformation of your ideas. I think this is a huge problem. And it's so the attraction of the strategic and ironic attitude conceals its enormous dangers. And I think this is all around us. So this is very important because I'm speaking now about something that's difficult to speak about because it's intangible, but which is pervasive all around us. And we have to deal with it. We have to have a conception of it in some way. And then comes then this fourth attribute of the period of darkening, which is the prominence of theory, of theoretical attitudes of law to law, the schools of jurisprudence, the mainstream schools, rights and principles, law and economics, legal process. I'm going to speak about them later. But in this context of my argument now, one way to understand the prominence and authority of these schools is to see them as attempts to make up for the waning of the institutional and ideological settlement. So it's as if they were proxies for the settlement. When the settlement was present, when it had immediacy in the historical circumstance, it didn't need to be represented by a theoretical proxy. It spoke in its own voice. But as it recedes, then, and it loses, as I said, clarity and authority, it has to be replaced by some automaton which will speak in its place. And that's theory. So I think that's one way to understand the much greater role of theory, of legal theory, in this period of darkening. So that's my fable, as it were. So let me make a couple of comments about this before I ask for your engagement. So I've already said what I regard as the personal danger, the spiritual danger to the individual of this situation, in which he has a strategic or ironic attitude to the beliefs, rather than a struggle to form ideas in which he can genuinely believe, exposing himself to the dangers of disillusionment. That's on the side of the individual. But then there's the side of society. And the side of society is that in this narrative that I just described of the three moments of refoundation, normalization, and darkening, change depends on a deus ex machina. It depends on an exogenous crisis, which then provokes the moment of refoundation as war or economic ruin. But what happens if there is no such crisis for an indefinite time? Nothing guarantees that there's a fixed visitation. It's as if the planet were to be visited every 90 so years by the comet, and that would then shake things up, and then we would go on and we would have a new program. We may have no such luck, collectively, society. And the individual, us, we, in our circumstance, may find that our entire lives fall in this period of darkening. So it seems to be unacceptable, both collectively and personally, to simply perform the role which has been assigned to us in this historical narrative. So the personal implication would be to find some way to reject the strategic or ironic attitude. And the collective implication would be to find some way to reshape our beliefs and institutions so as to diminish the dependence of change on crisis. And then, of course, the paradox or the vicious circle is that it may seem that the establishment of institutions that diminish the dependence of change on crisis, that make the regime more susceptible to change without crisis, itself depends on crisis. And so we have to ask how we are to break that vicious circle. So this part of my remarks about the three moments, about the rhythm, is empirical. I'm defending an account of our situation, and it's not anything that's in books. I think you can't find any book that's about this. But it's all around us. So it's the most basic characteristic of the situation. So you all have the same evidence that I have, and I wonder what you think of this. There's nothing recondite about any of these points. I'm providing a description to our shared experience in the historical circumstance. Yes?
I mean, I haven't developed totally coherent thoughts, but initially, I'm persuaded by the way you describe these three moments, but I wonder whether there is a horizon that we're seeing to this moment of darkening. Just because, at least in my lifetime, it seems like there has been an exit or a social crisis, both in the 2000s, maybe 9/11 and the 2008 economic crash. And at least perhaps in this election, in the United States as an example, it seems like there are two populist positions, one on either side of the aisle, that are reacting to this moment.
Yes.
With Bernie Sanders, on the one hand, offering a return to this New Deal or a retrenchment of it, and perhaps Donald Trump suggesting an escape from the New Deal and a return to nativism as a way to
correct
make the white population in the United States that's been caught up with after the New Deal
mm-hmm.
feel as if they've retained the power they've lost since then. So perhaps there is a horizon? I don't know.
Yes, but So a couple of comments. So not just in the United States, but in Europe, there is a populist reaction, much more on the right than on the left, to the present arrangements. But the populist reaction has no future, it has no legacy, unless it is translated into institutional arrangements, unless it has an institutional legacy. And there is an asymmetry between the intentions of the right and of the left. The right may not need to have an institutional program. The left must have one if it wants to change the situation and influence the primary distribution of advantage. So all of that is true. So nothing in the comments that I made just now was intended in a fatalistic spirit. It was just the opposite, that to understand this circumstance is then the beginning of a response to it. And not just a response to the present moment of darkening, but a response to the whole sequence. That is, it's not a premise. of the argument that I just made, that we are condemned to undergo forever this cycle of refoundation, normalization, and darkening, and to require crisis as the condition of transformation. On the contrary, what I think is that the extent to which change depends on crisis is a variable shaped by our institutions and beliefs, and that we can create institutions that diminish the dependence of change on crisis by making themselves susceptible to correction in the ordinary course of our activities. So then comes the question of the role of law in this. That's how we come to this discussion of law. So the way I'm speaking up to now, law and legal thought are the victims or the objects of this situation. They're bystanders. They are being influenced so by the moment in this trajectory. But potentially, they're also the agents or authors of a different response. So if we are to have alternatives, the alternatives surely wouldn't take the form of a mythical systemic substitution, a substitution of one system for another. The alternatives would have to be built from the inside out or from the bottom up, with the variations that already exist that would then become material for the construction of larger variations. And then law and legal thought become potential agents, not just of particular alternatives, but of breaking out of this whole sequence of refoundation, normalization, and darkness. That's the kind of argument that I'm trying to move toward in this set of claims. But I think that to be powerful, the programmatic argument has to have an anchor in our immediate experience and in our response to it. And that's why this claim that I'm making about what I call the period of darkening seems to me to be so important. Is there some other comment? Yes.
How conscious is the period of darkening? How do these people consciously think, well, I don't really believe this, but I'm going to agree?
Well, you tell me. I mean, as I say, at this moment, I'm making an empirical claim, which we all have the same evidence. So, because the situation in legal culture is all around us. I'm making this claim that the assumptions of the canonical practice of legal analysis are not fully believed in by their own practitioners. It's my observation. But you can test that observation as much as I. I wrote a little book which I ended saying that the jurists have become like priests who have lost their faith and kept their jobs. But we have the same evidence to look around and say whether that's the case. So one of the things that I observe in this regard is the the attitude toward the theoreticians. So I said that one of the attributes of this period in legal culture is that the theories become proxies for the receding settlement. The theoreticians seem to believe in their theories. But the attitude of the jurists toward the theoreticians is somewhat dismissive. They don't seem to take the theoreticians very seriously. And that's because they don't take the practice itself, which is being theorized, very seriously. So it's not as if these theoreticians were regarded as the central ideologists of the plan, as they were in the earlier period. It's treated as marginal. You're talking about political philosophy rather than legal theory narrowly, right?
Yes, but I'm wondering if part of this problem is the relationship between legal theory and political philosophy growing off
of So I stated when I referred earlier to the intellectual background of the institutional and ideological settlement, the dominant tendencies in political philosophy. Like, for example, the Rawlsian theory of justice. It's very abstract. It trades in the language of social contract theories. But its agenda, its practical agenda, or its pragmatic residue, is the philosophical justification of compensatory redistribution under social democracy. No one who believed that that political salvation would come from institutional reshaping would arrange political philosophy in that form. It's when you think the market's the market, but it has to obey distributive criteria, which are stated after the fact. And that seems to be the spirit of this whole situation. Yes. Yes.
It sounds like, in your opinion, that crisis is not a good way, or is the least ideal form, and that we shouldn't want that we should go towards a more, I guess, a less critical time where judges or like the legal system is more proactive.
No, what I was suggesting is that we shouldn't want to need crisis. It's not that crisis is somehow bad. It's that our dependence on crisis as the condition of change is bad. Because we don't control when the crisis comes. So if we have a set of arrangements which makes change depend on crisis, we're in the hands of these events in world history that we don't control. So let's just render the idea more abstract. You could say there are two basic classes of activities in society. There are the routine activities that we undertake within a framework of arrangements and assumptions that we take for granted. And then there are the extraordinary transformative or revisionist activities by which from time to time we challenge and change pieces of this framework of arrangements and assumptions. So I am arguing that we should desire to bring these two classes of activities closer and closer together so that our ability to challenge and change and even to envision the framework of our activities increases. And we are then less in the hands of fate. So it's a form of empowerment and of freedom in which our transformation of the framework arises more continuously out of the normal activity of life. That's the basic idea. So it's not an idea that crisis is bad. What is undesirable is our dependence on it.
So
possible. You know, for example, if you're suggesting that my computer's been a victim, so I should like get it already before that happens.
Yes.
So just like from a behavioral standpoint,
yes.
It's hard to convince a society, a group of citizens, that they should, you know, ditch the two-party system or ditch capitalism or ditch socialism when things are working sort of okay. So is it perhaps the job of legal theorists to sort of bring to light the not-so-good aspects of the current system, say we need to be very proactive? I think about, you know, the election at hand, politicians really like to pat themselves on the back when they bring an argument to the forefront. Should that be something we should encourage?
So it seems to me that among the elements of a response to this problem that you evoke, there are these three elements for someone who is interested in transformation. So one element is just as you suggest, to find inarticulate crisis. So crisis may not wear a readily discernible form. It may appear in other forms, right? The second aspect is to have a set of detailed institutional ideas or initiatives so that you can use crisis in the yet unrecognized form as an incitement to some form of transformation. But then comes the third element, which is you will be misguided or inhibited if you see institutional transformation only under the aegis of this systemic illusion that structural change would have to be the substitution of a whole system by another system, socialism for capitalism, one thing for another. That's just not how structural change happens. It never happened that way. So if we burden ourselves with that illusion, then we run the risk of reproducing an experience which is common in the world. So the experience is the institutionally conservative social democrat is an ex-Marxist. So he thinks or used to think that radical change would be the substitution of one system for another. It's not in the cards. And if it were in the cards, it would be too dangerous. So then what's left is to humanize the existing system. So what happens then is that this fantasy of systemic substitution becomes an alibi for its opposite, which is the idea of the humanizing management of the existing system. This is the lie that people tell themselves. And it's, of course, used to justify many forms of careerist abdication or resignation. But it's not the truth about structural change, because real structural change in the world is always piecemeal. And it can nevertheless be radical in its outcome if pursued in a certain direction under a certain conception. But if it is piecemeal, then everything lies in the details. And where are the details? The details are in the law, because it's the law that deals with the organization of society at the level of institutional detail rather than at the level of ideological abstraction. So this is all part of the tendency to which I argue we must struggle. But then we, in this effort, we have to begin to break the spell of the dominant style of legal analysis, which is enticing us to idealize this ad hoc arrangement that resulted from the settlement of the mid-20th century, and to pretend that it's some kind of system. But it's not a system. And of course, this attempt to present it as a system is justified as a noble Platonic lie, because in the name of pretending it's a system, we can make things better for the most vulnerable. That's the good part. Then the base part is the one you mentioned, and then the jurists will have more power. There'll be more fun and authority for them. And that's the kind of deal which is then arranged. But the deal, according to this narrative that I presented, is sinking under the weight of this recession of the earlier ideological and institutional self. Less and less believable, less and less clear, open to these ad hoc forms of populism that arise in the vacuum, and so forth. Yes?
So you described like one of the characteristics of the darkening as yes. Responding to the theory, and then you said that they're used as proxies for recondition and sort of devolve into automaton. And I'm curious if you were aware of that fact before the critical legal studies movement, or you learned it during the movement, or came to your attention after?
Well, this was all part of the contest at that time. We're going to talk about that. So. There was in the American Legal Academy, and the same situation exists in Europe, through the 1970s, a consensus. And the consensus was this post-New Deal consensus, viewing law as a legal thought as a system expounded in the vocabulary of impersonal policy and principle. So there was then an attempt to break this through this movement, this critical legal studies movement. But it wasn't one thing. There were different strands in the critical legal studies movement. And to my mind, the institutionalist strand is the one that has survived. But it was not the paramount one. It was not the most visible one. The most visible one was the radicalization of indeterminacy. So the idea that a piece of doctrine or of law can mean whatever you want it to mean, through argumentative manipulation. And to my mind, it was a complete dead end, intellectually and politically. And its attraction in the United States was the result of a very specific political situation. The radicals in the United States, the leftists, and even the progressives more generally, were marginalized. So, it was a piece of wishful thinking to say it doesn't matter who wins or loses in the political battles that result in the content of the law, because once the law falls into our hands, the hands of the jurists, we can make it mean whatever we want it to mean. So then you don't have to win power. All you have to be is a professional who can manipulate the interpretation of law. Well, that's not how things are. It doesn't matter who wins or loses. So this was a distortion. And for the radical leftists, they were content to be professors who could preach the doctrine of radical indeterminacy. For the liberal progressives, who felt they had failed to persuade the American people to take another direction, they thought there was a shortcut of gaining power in the federal judiciary and using judicial politics to circumvent the failures of political politics. So they would then obtain from the judges what they had failed to obtain from the people. And that, too, is a dangerous game and a shortcut that can't work for more than a very short time. There's no alternative. There's no alternative to politics. There's no alternative to political thought. There's no alternative to the imagination of alternatives. There is no shortcut. And this was part of the message. So these disputes continued within the critical legal studies movement. We'll come to that at another moment. Yes?
Just a quick comment on the narrative.
Yes.
So it feels like if transformation comes piecemeal, there's no reason for us to expect a refundation moment or to expect it before, you know, start transformation work. But then it feels that the narrative doesn't give us instrument to identify those current best practices that are attempting to do transformative work, because if it's all darkness, you know, there's no light, so nothing prevailing is good enough. So it feels like the narrative prevents us from identifying, you know, good examples to follow. So it doesn't give us a lot of guidance.
No, but I agree with you that this narrative, which is it's a historical fable. It's a simplified account of a historical progression. In and of itself, it gives no normative direction. Of course, we have to have a programmatic agenda. And the programmatic agenda can't arise simply from an analysis of the contradictions in law. We have to have a view of the direction. But the view of the direction shouldn't be filtered through through what I call the systemic illusion, that change, that real change or fundamental change is necessarily the substitution of one system for another. So let me give you an example of a terrain of debate. So in the practical debates about economic policy, now in the United States and to some extent in Europe, the progressives, on the whole, focus on the demand side of the economy and on compensatory redistribution through tax and transfer and on the counter-cyclical management of the economy through fiscal and monetary policy. They have no view of the supply side. They have no program for the supply side. So the supply side is abandoned to the right. And the right has a reified view of the supply side because it has a reified view of the organization of the market. But then, and nevertheless, there are many opportunities or incitements to the development of a progressive approach to the supply side. So I'm getting ahead of myself, but it's useful to state this now in response to your comment. After the decline of traditional mass production, there is a new practice of production emerging in all the major economies of the world, sometimes called post-Fordist, or the knowledge economy, or the experimental economy, but it remains very confined in narrow vanguards of production from which most of the labor force is excluded. Through what initiatives, through what institutional initiatives, could we work to establish this advanced practice of production in a form that is socially inclusive, disseminating it through much of the economy? We would need another kind of education focused on higher order analytic capabilities rather than on job-specific and machine-specific skills. We would need a set of endowments for the individual worker and citizen that are not dependent on the possession of any particular job or niche in the division of labor, but are universally portable. We would need a set of arrangements designed to facilitate cooperative competition among advanced firms that compete with one another but pool certain resources. So there is a circulation of people, practices, and ideas in the advanced sector, a characteristic of the advanced sector. That would require the development of new private law, a new private law working with relational contracts, incomplete contracts, organizing long-term relations among firms, rather than the traditional instantaneous contract among individuals. And it might require, as well, developing new regimes of property that made it possible for investors, managers, local communities, and workers to share stakes in the same productive enterprises. Fourth, it might require the reinvention of industrial policy so that we would not have to choose between the American model of arm's length regulation of business by government and the Northeast Asian model of imposition of unitary industrial policy top down by the bureaucratic apparatus of the state, a form of industrial policy designed to generalize access to advanced technology, to capital, to knowledge, experimentally and pluralistically. And that would be a new form of public law. So, And those are all initiatives on the supply side of the economy, not on the demand side. And being on the supply side, they necessarily have very detailed legal and institutional content. Now I ask, where is that position in the current debates? It's not accounted for by the populism. It's not accounted for by the exclusive focus on the New Deal entitlements. It requires a reshaping of the arrangements, in this case of the arrangements of production. And that then represents a way of getting out of this narrative of refoundation, normalization, and darkening. And in this alternative, law, legal thought, is not just a bystander. Legal thought is inevitably an agent. Because the solution, according to this view, is in the details, and the details are in the law. Now, having in mind this view that I've just presented, we can begin to understand a project that arises from contemporary law and legal thought. A project that only becomes clear when we understand the present practice of legal thought in this context of the social democratic compromise. The project of 19th century legal science was the project of working out the inbuilt legal and institutional content of the type of a free society or the type of a market economy. The characteristic project of 20th century legal thought under the aegis of this social democratic or New Deal compromise is a dialectical reorganization of all of law, law in general, and each branch of law as an interplay between rules and rights that organize individual and collective self-determination, and rules and rights that secure the conditions for the effective enjoyment of those rights of self-determination. So you know Anatole France's remark, the law allows everyone to sleep under the bridge. So in the view of the 20th century jurists, after the social democratic compromise, The idea was that the simple organization of rules and rights of self-determination was a sham. If there was no guarantee of the effective ability to exercise those rights. So the rights of individual and self, of individual and collective self-determination are a pure form. But the form won't be real unless we intervene to make them real. So a classic example in the evolution of legal thought and law was the view of the relation between contract law and labor law. So the basic claim that lies at the origin of modern labor law is that in the employment relation, the inequality of bargaining power is so severe that the contractual form becomes a sham. That is, economically dependent wage labor may be formally contractual, but is not in fact a contract, unless we intervene to correct for the severe inequality of bargaining power. And thus we organize a system of collective bargaining under labor law that reestablishes in the employment relation the reality of contract. And thus the effective conditions for the enjoyment of the right to contract. Freedom to contract and freedom of contract of the terms of the contract. That's an example. This is the characteristic preoccupation of 20th century law. And all of law came to be reshaped in the light of that project. So it happened, first of all, within each legal discipline. So, for example, within contract law, the relation between the traditional law of contract formation and the doctrines of unconscionability or of economic duress, which within contract were designed to secure the reality of contract. The form is not enough. It has to be real. Then it happened in the relation between different parts of law. I just gave the example of contract law and labor law. Labor law arose to make contract real in the context of the employment relation. And finally, it happened at the most general level in the relation between all of private law and all of public law. So you could understand all of public law in this spirit as intended to make real the assumptions or promises of private law. That's this project of saying that it's not enough to have a system of rights that secures self-determination in the economy and in politics. If we don't arrange things to make the exercise of these rights effective for everyone, otherwise it's a lie. Otherwise we have the form and we fail to have the substance. Now, from this account of the project, there results an enigma, which is the next thing that I want to explore. The enigma is this. The jurists in the 20th century came to think it's not enough to assign rights, especially rights of self-determination, of autonomy, if you don't also assure the practical conditions for their exercise. So the rights depend on practical conditions. In this sense, the rights are defeasible. They're only real if the practical conditions are fulfilled. But it would seem that there would always be a potential contrast of ideas about the obstacles to the effective enjoyment of the rights. So you have rights, and then you have a diagnosis. What prevents people from effectively exercising those rights? There's never going to be a single self-evident answer to that question with respect to any right. There are going to be different views, and the views will depend on alternative conceptions of the existing structure of society and of the alternatives to it. And so it seems that the emphasis on assuring the conditions for the effective enjoyment of the rights as the first step would be naturally and necessarily followed in a second step by an exploration of alternative strategies to secure the effective enjoyment of the rights. And these alternative strategies would inevitably take the form of different institutional directions, step by step, little by little. Not one big systemic substitution, but there would be multiple paths. So you'd have different conceptions of what the obstacle is, and these different conceptions would inform different responses, and the different responses would take institutional form. That's what you might expect, but it didn't happen. So that's the enigma. The enigma is that a remarkable feature of this project of 20th century law is that this passage from the emphasis on the effective enjoyment of rights to the exploration of alternative responses, alternative ways of securing the effective enjoyment of the rights, was severed, was truncated. So you have a professed interest in the effective enjoyment of the effective enjoyment of the rights that is bereft of any development of alternative institutional responses. Now, it's very interesting to explore this enigma, because what it will reveal is a profound ambivalence of the dominant form of legal thought to the established social regime. The dominant practice of legal thought is idealizing, or idealistic, if you want. And I think it cannot adequately be understood as simply an apology or a reproduction of the established social order. It is ambivalent. Now, before I go ahead with my exploration of this enigma, let me stop and ask whether you understand the enigma that I'm trying to represent. Do you see the problem? Does someone have a question about the problem? So the focus in the 20th century is on the practical conditions for the effective enjoyment of the rights. The basic attitude of the 20th century jurists is the formal rights by themselves aren't enough if we don't work to ensure the conditions for their enjoyment. But the definition of the conditions for their enjoyment depends on your diagnosis of the obstacles to their exercise. And these different conceptions of the obstacles lead in different directions. So it seems that there could never be just one way of assuring the effective enjoyment of the rights. There would be multiple ways, depending on these alternative conceptions of the structure or of the next steps of the possibilities. And these different conceptions would inform alternative institutional trajectories. So how was it possible for for 20th century legal thought to embrace with enthusiasm this cause of assuring the effective enjoyment of the rights without taking what seems to be the inevitable next step, which is to examine the institutional alternatives. That's the enigma that I'm trying to present. Now, rather than exploring this enigma in the abstract, I want to give a particular example of how it works out in contemporary law and legal thought. And the example I want to take is the American practice of so-called complex enforcement or the structural injunctions. So to this end, let me contrast two kinds of procedure. So first is the classic procedural framework. There are individual agents first, litigating. Second, the view of the evil that has to be redressed by the law is that there is some transgression of right, some localized transgression of right, or some misallocation of rights and resources. And third, the remedy, the way of redressing the misallocation, is to declare the right and to put things back so that the right holder enjoys his right in his zone of entitlement. But there is no invasion of the structural background of society. So the classic procedural framework is supposed to be structurally neutral. It's not supposed to change anything about the underlying arrangements. Now comes a second procedural framework. Now the agents are collective. They're groups. Second, the evil that is to be redressed by the procedure is some tension, some contradiction between an ideal embodied in law and described in the language of policy and principle, and some area of social organization or social practice. And the remedy is a correction of that area of social practice or that social organization. So the remedy is localized, but it is structural. It is at the same time localized and structural. And this is the procedural form that in the United States came to be called complex enforcement or structural injunctions. And it has its equivalents in Europe and in much of the world. Now, it's important to understand the intimate affinity between the second procedural framework and the aspirations of the canonical practice of legal thought. The canonical practice of legal thought, this method of reasoned elaboration that deals with the law purposively in the language of idealized policy and principle, attributes to law large ideals, which it describes in the language of principle and policy. And because it attributes to law these large ideals, it makes possible a tension or a contradiction between the message that it ascribes to the law and the organization of some part of society. So the practice of complex enforcement or structural injunctions is the second procedural framework, is powerfully influenced and inspired by the aspirations of this now canonical practice of legal analysis, the method of reasoned elaboration. So you find a branch of social practice or a social organization that you see as being in contradiction to the law as the law is interpreted in this idealizing fashion. And in the practice of the structural injunctions, it will typically be a school system, or a prison system, or a mental asylum. And the judges will say, this organization, or this part of social practices, falls beneath the acceptable threshold of what we can accept given our interpretation of the law, the ideals that we ascribe to the law. Now there's a problem. And the problem is this. On the one hand, on this approach to the law, it seems that there's a mandate. There's a mandate to intervene if there's a part of society, of social practice, of social organization that contradicts the law, the contradiction has to be resolved. That's the mandate. But on the other hand, it seems that there is no branch of government that is equipped, financed, and legitimated to engage in this work, which is localized but nevertheless structural. The judiciary is designed, equipped, and financed to deal with conflicts over the allocation of individual rights. And you can make distinctive objections to the executive or the legislature to deal with these problems. There's no branch of government designed for a form of intervention that is structural but localized. So what happens? Or what happened in fact? What happened in fact is that the branch of government that wanted to do it did it. And in the United States, it turned out to be the federal judiciary. They were the authors of this practice of structural injunctions or complex enforcement. They were the ones who began to take over prison systems or school systems or mental asylums. But there were then two ideas about how to organize this practice of the structural injunctions. One idea says, if there's a substantive mandate in the law, execute the mandate. Even if there is no branch of government ideally suited to exercise it. Any branch can exercise the mandate. The mandate has priority over the institutional proprieties. The contrasting idea is, do only what is institutionally proper. If there is no branch of government that is designed, financed, and legitimated to execute the mandate, there is no real mandate. That's the opposite idea. Now, how can we understand, in fact, the practice of the structural injunctions? It seems to be an ad hoc splitting of the difference between these two principles. It seems to be impossible to reject either of the two principles. So the federal judges in the United States, during this high point of judicial intervention, begin to intervene in these organizations, like prisons, schools, and mental asylums. But why don't they go further? Why don't they begin to intervene in the banks, for example? What's the criteria, what's the criterion for choosing some of these organizations over others? Once you begin to intervene in the structural background of society, where do you stop? One obstacle to the effective enjoyment of rights is based on another obstacle. So then you're in a succession. So it seems that what actually happened has to be described in the following way. They intervened as much as they could until they ran out of power. So the judges would be allowed to intervene in relatively peripheral organizations, but not in the central organizations of the economy and of power. In a prison, but not in a bank. But why? So it's as if the substantive rationalization or idealization of law has as its counterpart the derationalization of the procedural system. The procedural system is ad hoc. And what is revealed then is this profound ambivalence of the dominant practice of legal thought to the established regime. Is it to idealize the regime? If the idealization is serious, does it mean that there should be intervention, structural intervention to correct things? If there's structural intervention, why is it only in the peripheral organizations and not in the central organizations of politics and of the economy? So, in a different way of thinking, you might draw the following two lessons from this experience. You might say, if there is a mandate in the law to begin reshaping things, and there is no appropriate institution, no appropriate role in the legal process, you begin with the inappropriate role, the judges, as they're now organized, but then you form later a different branch of the state, specifically designed, financed, equipped, and legitimated to do this work. And the implication for thought would be, then you want a form of legal thought that doesn't treat the institutions as a shadowy background, but rather treats them as its central topic. And it can't be this canonical practice of legal analysis. Now we have just a couple of minutes, and I want to ask you what your view is of this practice of the structural injunctions. Just focus on this question that I asked you. Why is it that the focus of the structural injunctions is on the relatively peripheral organizations? What's the logic by which it's the practice of the structural injunction stops in one place rather than another place? If a judge can seize a prison or a school system, why can't he seize other things? Why can't he begin to seize some of the central organizations in the society if they too are found to contradict the ideals ascribed to the law? Yes? No, of course they're not. But the people whom the judges are displacing when they intervene in the other organizations were also not willing to give up their power. So I don't dispute that the judges as unelected officials without legitimacy would not be allowed to start reshaping all of society piece by piece as if they were Benthams who were in the seat of judicial power. That's obvious. But what I'm trying to understand is the inner logic of this activity of the structural injunctions. So it seems from the outside on its face that it's just a factual limitation, a limitation of power, as you suggest. They go as far as they can until they run out of power. But that's not a legal theory. That's just the description of a correlation of forces. Yes? Well, how does interest group pluralism explain it? Yes. But yeah, but that's a way of restating the problem. We understand why it would never occur in practice, but the issue is how can we make sense of this as something more than an adaptation to a limit of power? Were you going to say something?
Yeah, I just. I wonder if it has something to do with the discussion we had earlier about kind of the self-deception that happens in the judicial practice, in that judges are sort of out, they don't necessarily believe in full in sort of the tools they've been given, but they use the tools to advance what they might call creative interests, what we might call careerist interests. Perhaps they recognize that when they intervene in schools and in prisons, they are doing what people think they are supposed to be doing, and they get sort of careerist capital from that. Whereas if they're intervening in banks or something more controversial, that actually poses a threat to not only their job, but sort of legitimacy of the profession in which they work. So it's almost like, perhaps it's not conscious, but there's like a self-protective kind of sort of psychological process happening.
Well, I think all of these explanations are plausible as explanations. But what I was trying to ask you about was whether we can make sense of the limitations of this practice. The premise of my question is that we can't make sense of it. But I was trying to ask whether we can, and whether I'm missing something in this. And my interest really is to suggest what seems to be a contradiction in the dominant form of legal analysis. Its idealizing character makes possible its contradiction to aspects of the social order, but its emptiness of institutional content deprives it of the tools with which to act on this contradiction.